When most people think of IBM, they think computers. Whether it's IBM PCs or room-sized devices rented to NASA or corporations, International Business Machines' reputation is nearly synonymous with computers. But when Howard Aiken, a PhD student, made his proposal for one of the first digital computers to IBM, the company was already a quarter of a century old and worth millions of dollars. To understand what the company did before Aiken's proposal kickstarted a series of events that would redefine both IBM and the entire world, we'll have to roll the clock back and zoom in on some of the business machines that IBM is named after. I'm Daniel Seehausen, and this is The Answer Archive. In the last two decades of the 1800s, the United States encountered a problem with the census. The data collected during the 1880 census was so vast that the Census Bureau determined that the counting would not be finished until after the 1890 census had already begun. In 1889, they sponsored a contest to create a more efficient system for processing. Two competitors proposed human-based systems, but one of the contestants, Herman Hollerith, entered a mechanical solution that used punched cards. In the end, his devices calculated far faster than the human methods. He won the contract. While large tabulating machines like Hollerith's were a novelty, mechanical aids to calculation were much older. These new mechanical computers competed with human computers, who were increasingly assisted in processing information by mechanical calculators and adding machines. And for the storage of that data, a new device called the typewriter was growing in popularity. These business machines came into a market greedy for efficiency and created the demand for the digital calculators and personal computers of the 1970s. People have hated doing math by hand since forever, or at least since 1623, when Wilhelm Schickard developed his calculating clock. It would have been capable in assisting in the four basic operations. Sadly, a fire destroyed it before it was ever used. Then Schickard and his family died of the bubonic plague. Despite Schickard's dismal fate, other calculating devices soon followed. While Wilhelm Schickard was working on his calculating clock in 1623, a promising young mathematician and philosopher named Blaise Pascal had just been born. Early in his life, Blaise's father did not believe that his son had any future in mathematics and told him not to waste time reading such books. In rebellion, Blaise would secretly read about math. When his father found out, he relented and instead used math lessons as a reward when Blaise did well in his other studies. This passion for mathematics did not transfer to the tedious work of adding up his father's tax collection figures. So he drew up a device called the Pascaline to mechanize the tedium. He made around 50 different designs of this machine over the years and even attempted to sell some Pascalines, but was never successful. Many designers iterated on the mechanical calculator in the next three centuries, but none took hold in the business market until the turn of the 20th century. In the 1880s, a young man named William Bouroughs worked long hours at a bank, adding up ledgers and checking them for errors. He thought that this was an annoying waste of time to do by hand, and pondered on a way to help others like him get out of this boring work. After leaving the bank due to health issues, he started a venture to produce adding machines. Burroughs gathered investors and promised them shares in his new American Arithmometer Company. Luckily for his shareholders, Burroughs was a dedicated man. He worked so tirelessly that his office mate said he would frequently leave with Burroughs at his workbench and return with him still there in the morning. Despite his drive, it took years to bring his machines to market. And when he did start selling them, he still felt it was too soon. After some pressure from his investors, he reluctantly built and sold 50 models. However, his worst fears were confirmed when a design flaw allowed user error to cause miscalculation, leaving customers dissatisfied. After working for 72 hours straight, Burroughs developed a solution. He recalled the 50 faulty units and replaced them with an improved model. In celebration, Burroughs hurled all 50 of the malfunctioning machines out the window and said he'd ended the last of his troubles. By the time of his death in 1898, the American Arithmometer Company had picked up steam and was selling hundreds of units per year. In 1901, they sold thousands. The new market leader reincorporated as the Burroughs Adding Machine Company in honor of their late founder. They would go on to be a future competitor of IBM. Though often forgotten now, mechanical calculators were common in offices until the 1970s. Burroughs had a head start in the market, but not for long. The business world demanded more time savers. Mechanical calculators were one of many new pieces of office equipment. And Herman Hollerith started marketing his tabulation systems to corporations instead of just the census. But his punched cards were competing with another, simpler means of storing data, the typewriter. E. Remington and Sons, known for manufacturing weapons, wanted to diversify. They began manufacturing farm equipment, sewing machines, and typewriters. The other diversification efforts would fail, but typewriters eventually took off, with the Remington No. 1 being the first commercially successful typewriter. However, at first, there was great public resistance to the device. People were often offended when they received type letters instead of handwritten ones, and most businessmen saw it as useless. So in order to market the typewriter, two things needed to happen. People had to know what typewriters were, and they had to think they were useful. To gain recognition, many companies producing typewriters began suing each other. A lot. These lawsuits were a sham battle intended to spark public interest in the typewriter. The next tactic used to market the typewriter would also be eerily familiar: celebrity endorsements. Hundreds of machines were given to public figures. The most famous recipient was Samuel L. Clemens, better known by his pseudonym, Mark Twain. He wrote, "Please do not divulge the fact that I own a machine. I have entirely stopped using the typewriter for the reason that I could never write a letter with it to anybody without receiving a request by return mail that I should not only describe the machine, but state what progress I have made in the use of it, etc., etc. I do not like to write letters, and so I do not want people to know that I own this curiosity-breeding little joker." Despite his complaints, Mark Twain was one of the first authors to submit an entire manuscript written on a typewriter. The Adventures of Tom Sawyer. Additionally, people had to learn how to use typewriters. Sadly, in the early days of typing, a sexist debate needed settling. Many claimed that only men were strong enough to use them. In response, the YMCA bought 6 Remington typewriters and gathered women to teach them typing. They were so successful that many typing schools for young women were established. And over the decades, millions of women became typewriter girls in offices all around America. Business machines like the typewriter opened offices to women for the first time, and many used this opening to push equality. With all these new typists, demand skyrocketed. By 1900, 100,000 typewriters had been sold. Throughout the 20th century, they became ubiquitous in offices and homes. With this popularity came consolidation, which became a trend in the office product industry. For example, Remington's typewriter division was spun off and later merged with another corporation to become Remington Rand. The company Hollerith founded after the census was not immune to the trend. It merged with 3 other businesses to form the Computing, Tabulating, Recording, or CTR, company in 1911. By the point that Herman Hollerith entered the office equipment market with his tabulating machine, typewriters were common, and mechanical calculators were taking off. Burroughs, Remington Rand, and many others would go on to moderate success in the future computing industry. Despite the slower start, CTR would go on to dominate them all under a new name, IBM. IBM's market dominance in the mid-20th century was so complete that all the other competition was frequently referred to as IBM's 7 dwarves. But how that all occurred is a story for another time.